Good morning, everyone. We'd like to worship all those who are visiting and all those who are joining us virtually. We miss you all. And let's begin with an opening prayer. Almighty God, we pray for your blessing on the church in this place. Here may the faithful find salvation and the careless be awakened. Here may the doubting find faith and the anxious be encouraged. Here may the tempted find help and the sorrowful comfort. Here may the weary find rest and the strong be renewed. Here may the aged find consolation and the young be inspired. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Now join me in the call to worship. Please enjoy Shirley's prelude this morning. Thank you, Shirley. And now that our hearts are quieted, please now join me with the call to worship. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me.
You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar.
You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways.
Before a word is on my
Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts.
See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting.
Please join me in the prayer of adoration. Wish you for creating this world in all beauty, for redeeming the world through Christ our Lord, and for sending us the gift of your Spirit to encourage, instruct, and sustain us. We long for your Spirit to work among us now, to inspire our praise, to challenge us with your truth, and to equip us for service in your world. Amen. And now join me in the call of confession. Spring Carol, all right. I should know that since I'm singing.
Shines purer than all the angels heaven can boast.
Now will you please join me in the call to confession? Remember, all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. Our old selves were crucified with him so that we might be slaves to sin no more. Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sin. Prayer of confession. Almighty God, you love us. But you have not loved you. You call, but we have not listened. We walk away from neighbors in need, wrapped in our own concerns. We condone evil, prejudice, warfare, and greed. God of grace, help us to admit our sin, so that as you come to us in mercy, we may repent, turn to you, and receive forgiveness through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. And now a moment of personal confession of sin. Hear the good news of God's promise. Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and live to all that is good. Therefore, know that in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we are all forgiven, and we are all being made whole. And all God's people said, Amen.
Thank you. As we continue now in our worship this morning, we look to the reading and hearing of God's word. And as we do that, we do so in prayer. Let us pray. Great and gracious God, inspire us by your Holy Spirit that we might hear what you have prepared for us this morning. In your word and in your hymns and in your liturgy, that we might receive that word and allow it to live in our hearts and in our lives. Quiet in us any voices but your own, that what we hear might be your word and what we do might be your will, that we might do all for your honor and for your glory. For it is in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning comes to us from the Gospel of Luke, from the 10th chapter, beginning at the 38th verse. Hear now God's word. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her to help me." "Martha, Martha," he replied, "you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her." This is the word of the Lord. This is one of those scriptures that has a lot to do with family dynamics. Family dynamics that we are pretty familiar with. If we allow ourselves to view this as a story about sisters, if you have siblings, this kind of rings pretty accurate. Mary and Martha have a brother named Lazarus. Lazarus is not a part of this story, but appears in other stories with Mary and Martha. They are friends of Jesus. They are very good friends of Jesus, for John records in his gospel that when Lazarus fell ill, seriously ill, mortally ill, that they sent word to Jesus saying, "The one you love is ill." So there's a relationship here. Jesus is just not a stranger who has decided to stop off at someone's house. He is stopping by to visit a friend. We know this, as I say, from other places that where these people appear. So Jesus is on the way from one place to another, as he often is in his ministry, and he decides to drop in and see Martha and Mary. Immediately, Martha, being the good Hebrew wife that she is, woman of the house, kicks it into gear and gets out the good dishes and starts preparing and setting the table and cooking the food and making sure Jesus is comfortable and all the things a good hostess does. She is practicing the law and tradition of hospitality in the Hebrew tradition, even if she's practicing it to the extreme. Now, Mary, on the other hand, is quite the opposite. Mary, on the other hand, decides that the better of the choices that she has is for her to simply sit with Jesus and enjoy his company and listen to whatever it is that Jesus wants to say to her. She enjoys Jesus' company. She enjoys his presence. And now Martha introduces what is the point or what Jesus wants to illustrate in this story. And in true sibling fashion, she becomes irate that Mary does not share the same concern that she does about hospitality. She has had enough of rushing around the house, getting things ready, practicing hospitality without any help. And she says to Jesus, "Tell her to help me." Siblings, you gotta love them, you know? This is a story right out of family dynamics. And Martha and Mary are familiar enough with Jesus that Martha is able to go to Jesus and say, "Don't you care that I'm the only one doing anything here? Tell my sister to help me." And Jesus responds in a way that I don't think Martha was prepared for. He says to Martha, "Martha, you're distracted. You're worried. See what you're doing to yourself? You're worried about all of these things." Now, he doesn't say that her actions are not appropriate. He does not say that practicing hospitality is a bad thing. In fact, as I said before, it is the law of the Hebrews that you must practice hospitality when someone comes into your house. What Jesus is saying to Martha is, don't let it distract you. Don't let that be the focus of this visit that I've made with you. You're a little over the top. Your choice is good. But there's a better choice. Mary sits with the guest. She sits with Jesus, and Jesus says, "Mary has chosen the better of things." What Mary has chosen by listening to me will not be taken away from her. The choice that we see in this story between serving the guest and listening to the guest is not a choice between good and bad. There's really no bad here in the story, except maybe Martha's distraction with serving. There is a choice, and then there is a better choice. There's something a little bit better here than you have chosen, Martha. If we stop and think about it, knowing what we know now, Mary and Martha have in their home, in their presence, that which is divine. The divine presence of Jesus has come to their house. He's there in their home, sitting with them, reclining with them, eating with them. Martha's serving, while appropriate, will end. And that will be the end of it, save perhaps for a memory of the time Jesus stopped by. But what Mary has chosen, listening, will stay with her. Those words will be in her mind and in her heart, and no one ever will be able to take away those words, which are in fact the words of life. I can almost envision Jesus saying to Martha, "Martha, come here, sit down for a minute. Just stop, okay? Just stop and listen to what I have to say." Jesus is present with them. But you know, Jesus is present with us too. Jesus is present with us even though he is not here in person, in flesh and blood. We Christians believe that the Holy Spirit brings the presence of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and that Jesus is here with us, not just in this place which is called by his name, but in our lives, in our homes, where we work. Jesus is most especially present when we gather around this table, as we do from time to time, to celebrate the sacrament of communion. In the middle of communion, in the middle of having the meal together, stop and listen to the words of Jesus. This meal is our Thanksgiving day every time we prepare it. It is like Thanksgiving because the whole family is present. Children, old people, young people, everybody is present here at the table and is welcome at the table. In fact, in some traditions, the sacrament itself is called Eucharist, which comes from the Greek word meaning to give thanks or to be thankful. In the sacrament, we give thanks for the presence of God, which is ours in the bread and in the cup. This is my body. This is my blood. It is for you. In the sacrament, we give thanks for Jesus and for his sacrifice on our behalf. In the sacrament of baptism, anytime we baptize another person, whether it be an infant, a child, an adult, we remember our own baptism. We remember that in baptism we are called to turn away from that which is evil and old and turn toward God in repentance. That's what the word means, 180-degree turn. We turn around, we hear the voice of Jesus, and we listen, and we come, and in the sacrament we die to our old life to be raised to the new. Another way we have the presence of Jesus with us is in the scriptures, in the Bible, in the words of the Bible. We see God revealed. The Trinity revealed, the Son revealed, the Spirit revealed. It is all there. All we have to do is read. And not a lot. When you sit down and read the Bible, it's not meant that you would sit there for hours and read and read and read. Just read a story. Read a parable. Read a psalm. Read a chapter. Do it in meditation and devotion, or do it as a part of an intentional study where you're with other people who say, well, I think that this is what the words mean, and I think this is what the words mean. Because no matter how many times you read the scriptures, there is always the potential for some new thing to be revealed. A memory sticks with me. Very early on in my years as a pastor, I preached a very familiar text. I preached the text out of John where Andrew sees Jesus and goes and follows him. And I pointed out in that he was first a disciple of John the Baptist before Jesus. It says so right there in the words. But after worship, I had an older woman come up to me. She was well into her 80s at the time. And she said to me, you know, I've read that story. I've heard that story read so many times. And this is the first time I heard those words. The first time that the word became present with her in that way. And so it is with Scripture, not every time, but from time to time, depending on our own situation. Jesus is present with us in the people that God places around us. Did you ever wonder why God brings certain people into your life and not others? Oh, I have. But they're there for a reason. They're there as part of God's presence and God's leading and God's molding us and helping us to learn and to grow into the life that we are called to grow into when we are baptized in Christ Jesus. And we obviously have God's presence with us in prayer. When we pray, there is that sense that God is listening, that God is hearing us. Otherwise, why would we pray? Why would we need to say the words of prayer if we did not believe that they were being heard? Sometimes we have to hear Jesus' message to Martha. Slow down. Pump the brake a little bit. Listen to what's being said. I was reminded as I prepared this sermon of an old hymn. And I'm not going to read the whole hymn. Hymns are meant to be sung, not read, but they are poetry. The hymn is Take Time to Be Holy. I just want to read a couple verses. Take time to be holy, the world rushes on. Much time spent in secret with Jesus alone. By looking to Jesus, like him thou shalt be, thy friends in thy conduct, his likeness shall see. Take time to be holy, be calm in thy soul. Each thought and each motive beneath his control. Thus led by his Spirit to fountains of love, thou soon shall be fitted for service above. Just slow down. You move too fast. Take time to hear what God is saying. In all the necessary tasks of Christian living. And we are called to tasks of service and tasks of hospitality and tasks of mission and tasks of evangelism. And we are all called to do those things which the Spirit gives us gifts to do. But sometimes we need to hear Jesus' words to the sisters in this parable. And in choosing those things which are good, to choose that which is better. That is to listen. To see Jesus in the sacraments. To see him presiding at table or at the font. To allow the words of the liturgy, the prayers, and the responses settle on our mind, to be open to what God is saying, if anything at all. As I said, as we read the scriptures, do so with as open a mind as you can. The thing you don't want to do when reading the Bible is to sit down and say, I have no idea what's being written here. Because you won't. You've already put up a roadblock. But read the words and allow the Spirit to move, if that's what the Spirit wants to do. Notice the people around you. Notice how they influence you. how they sometimes even define who you are or what you do, because like it or not, know it or not, we act differently around different people. Pray. The scriptures tell us to pray without ceasing, to pray without stopping. Our life should be a life of prayer. It's an attitude more than a posture, although those things are helpful to pray, standing up or sitting down, hands raised, hands down. Those things can be helpful because they begin to help us understand and realize what we're doing. But a prayer can be spoken as you see that ambulance rushing down the street with its lights and sirens on, to just say, Lord, be with whomever there is that needs them. That's praying without ceasing. But prayer is not a one-way line. Prayer is not us talking to God. It is, but that's not all it is. Sometimes in our petitions and in our crying out, and perhaps even in those deepest moments when we actually do cry out to God in prayer, just stop. Just take a moment to listen. Don't be distracted by your own prayer. What is God saying to you? What are the thoughts that come into your mind at that time that might be appropriate to what you're praying about? What are those memories that you have that might be conjured up by the words of your prayer that God, through the Spirit, is inspiring you to remember? What are those revelations? What are those new things that come to you as you pray? Every now and then, we answer our own prayers. Every now and then, when we finally get around to giving words, not necessarily audible words, but giving words to our thoughts and to our joys and to our sorrows, that we begin to understand ourselves better. That's God speaking to us. What is God saying? How is God answering your prayer? How is the presence of God being felt in your life? Of all the things in life that are needful, in all the tasks that are needful, in all the doings that are needful, one stands out among the many. Stop. Sit down. And listen to the words of the author of life. Listen to the words of life that the Spirit, that Christ through the Spirit, is speaking to you. Seek God and His righteousness and His kingdom, and all these things will be yours as well. To God be honor, glory, praise, dominion, and power now and always. Amen. Let us now offer an affirmation of faith. Put once we hear God's word proclaimed in word and scripture, we make a response. Sometimes that's in ancient confessions and creeds. Sometimes in new creeds and confessions, sometimes in scripture. Today, our affirmation of faith comes from the book of Acts. So together, let's affirm our faith. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear.
Him is guide me, thou great Jehovah.
Now, as we worship, let us invite God's presence into our lives as we look to God in prayer, laying before God that which is on our heart and our spirit. Let us pray together. O Lord God, come to us and abide with us, live with us, make your home with us. We open the door and ask you to come into our busy lives. Our lives of serving, our lives of teaching, our lives of helping others. All as we seek to be faithful followers of your Son. And as we do that, help us to take a few moments here and there to just stop and check in and listen. Are we on the right path? Are we doing the right thing? Do we need to do something different? For we know that if we ask, you will answer. If we seek, you will find us. And if we knock on the door, you will open it to us and you will answer us. if we are listening. Help us, O Lord, to listen to your voice in prayer, to your voice in those around us, to your voice as it comes to us in worship, that we might grow more and more into the likeness of your Son, whose name we bear as Christ-like, as a Christian. We pray, as always, for those who are sick, for those who are in need of care. We pray for your healing to be with them. We pray for all of those who are grieving, the loss of someone whom they loved, or who are grieving the loss of a job, or the loss of a relationship. For grief takes many forms, Lord, and we lift up those who are grieving to your eternal comfort. We pray for those who lead us. Leadership is a weighty task, O Lord, and is not to be taken on lightly. And so we pray for those who lead us in the world, in our nation, in our state, in this local area. We pray for them. And we pray that they might be wise in their leading, and they might do that which is right and that which is good above all else. We pray also for those who lead us in the church, for those who lead us in the church worldwide, for the church, leaders of the church in this nation, and the leaders in this place. For all who lead have a place of leadership and are necessary to lead us in the way you have called us in Christ Jesus our Lord. Empower our leaders in the church by the power of your Holy Spirit to do that which is pleasing to you. Equip them with your Spirit as they lead. And be with those of us who are led, that we might be led by those you have called as our leaders, that we might follow where they lead, that together we might serve Christ, who alone is head of the church. We pray that you would be with us in our daily living, in the daily routines of work and leisure, of worship and service, and in all the things that fill our days. We pray that they might all be pleasing to you, and that we would not feel guilty or ashamed if you were to stop by our home. We pray now, Lord, for those things which are most important to us, which are closest to us, for those events and things and people that are heaviest upon our heart, that you might also hear these prayers. And so, are there any that we need to remember this morning? And in silence, let us remember those who are on our hearts. offer up ourselves and our lives as a pure and holy sacrifice dedicated to your service. All that we have is a gift from you, O Lord, a trust that you have given to us for our keeping. And we give you thanks for all the blessings which we have poured out, which are too numerous for us to know. And we pray that you would forgive us when we forget your blessings in the living of our lives. We give you thanks that we are able not only to contribute monetarily to your kingdom here on earth, but that we also might contribute those gifts which you have gifted us in service to the church, to you, and to others. And now, O Lord, hear us as we unite our voices together in prayer, praying the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us also pray a prayer of thanksgiving. In gratitude, O Lord, for all which you have given to us, we give you praise and glory. We thank you for food to eat, for work to do, and strength to work. We thank you for your presence with us in all times and in all places. And we ask you to continue to pour out your blessings upon us. In Christ Jesus our Lord. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with each of you and those whom you love this day, this night, and forevermore, world without end. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you.